If you can shop, you can do research, and here's how. I think I've said before that I'm not the biggest fan of research, mostly because it often gets lumped in with writing, even though it is, strictly speaking, its own thing. And that's probably coming more from me as a teacher than as a writer. I get so excited to teach writing, and then I get stuck teaching research, which kind of bums me out. But we live in a world where everyone has to take English 101, and Research 101 doesn't exist. So alas, here we sit, doing research. Now, academic library research can feel pretty daunting, especially if it's something that you haven't done much of before. But the good news is that it's really just an application of skills that you probably already have. You just might not know it yet. So let's get right into it and see how doing online research is pretty much the same thing as doing online shopping. Shopping often begins with a recognition that you need something. It could be a pair of shoes, a microphone, an ice cream machine, or a dictionary. Once you recognize that need, your job is to determine which of the many products that are out there is the one that you actually want. Surely you aren't going to spend all your hard-earned money on any old thing. So your shopping is driven by the question, which item should I purchase? Everything you do from here on will be dependent on that question. And research is similarly driven by an overarching question. When you're doing library research, as opposed to something like designing your own experiment, you may have questions about your research topic that you're trying to answer, but the main question will really boil down to, which sources do I want to include in my project? Of course, in order to find those sources, you're going to be guided by a research question that is more specific to your particular project. In fact, we've already talked about how to develop effective research questions, so check out the link in the description. But the main point is that when you're shopping, you're looking to find one product out of many, and when you're doing research, you're looking to find a few sources out of many. Either way, you're being guided by the question, which one will I pick? Now, before you go too far, you might take stock of what you already know and what constraints or requirements you might have. Maybe you know that you don't like a particular brand, or that you have to work within a set budget, or perhaps you know that you need to use the product in a specific way or under certain conditions. All of these factors will inform your search and help you to narrow down your options before you even start searching. For example, if you're working within a budget, you can immediately eliminate anything that's too expensive, and you can also probably weed out some things that are way under your budget because they might be cheap or inferior. And the same process is at work when you're doing library research. Before you even start looking for sources, it's good to consider what you already know and what constraints or requirements there are for your particular project. For example, if your audience is going to be more willing to listen to academic sources, you'll want to prioritize looking in academic journals and books rather than any run-of-the-mill website. Then, if there are specific things that you don't know yet but feel like you need to find out, you can prioritize those in your search. And of course, you can consider whether you're going to need sources that are more factual or ones that provide more analysis and commentary. You might not know all of these things before you get started, and that's okay. Research develops over time. But either way, you're going to want to take some time to take stock of what you know and what you still need to know. Once you start, it's common to go out there and just see what you can find. You might go to a store just to look around or visit an online retailer and start reading customer reviews. At this stage, you're not just imagining what you might find, you're going out there and seeing what's actually for sale. Perhaps you find out that there are only 3 or 4 items that fit your criteria, or maybe the local shop only has 1 or 2 items that fit your budget. This initial survey of what's out there gives you a good sense of your options, and from there, you're in a position to start making some decisions. And again, the same thing can happen when you're doing research. You might start by going to Google and just seeing what you can find. At this point, your job is to get a sense of the big picture and to gain a basic understanding of your topic and of what kinds of sources are even out there. For me, this process usually involves skimming through heaps and heaps of article titles and abstracts so that I can weed out those sources that just aren't going to be as useful or helpful for my particular project. Again, at this point, the task is just to get a feel for the topic and a sense for what's really out there. And like with shopping, once you do have that basic understanding, you're in a good position to start making some decisions. Perhaps for a lot of people, just reading customer reviews on an online shop is enough to make a purchasing decision. But if you're anything like me, you might have an inherent distrust of those kinds of reviews. Sure, there are only 5 negative reviews out of 1,000, but what if I'm number 6? So for me, my search usually begins at an online retailer to get a sense for what people are saying about products and to see what's most popular. but I almost always end up looking for professional reviews and recommendations too. And that requires a different and more refined kind of searching. So instead of just looking up generic terms like whisk or shoes, I start looking for specific products, and I might even include the search term reviews in order to get more in-depth information and recommendations than I could with those basic customer reviews. At this stage of shopping, I'm looking for more specific things, and I'm using more specific search terms to get there. I've narrowed down my focus to a few likely products, and now I'm going deep, learning as much as I can about a few things instead of learning a little bit about a lot of things. And of course, the same process holds true in online library research. The more you know, the more you'll be able to narrow down your research. In fact, as you read more, you'll become increasingly familiar with key terms and concepts that will help you to refine your search terms and that will lead you to more useful sources. Now, the name of the game is not to understand the broad topic, but to become deeply acquainted with the aspects of that topic that relate specifically to your project. The more your project progresses, the narrower and narrower it will likely become, because you're in a better position to ignore or reject those sources that won't help you to do your job. Just like with shopping, this more focused phase of research is where you'll really start making the decisions about where you're going and what you're willing to leave behind. Once you've read reviews, consulted the professionals, and become an expert on each of the products you're considering, you're ready to make a decision and go forward with your purchase. So congratulations, your investigation has paid off, and you can have confidence that you're getting the best product for your needs. The final stage of research is similarly rewarding. As you deepen your knowledge, you'll be able to zero in on those sources that will help you to accomplish your rhetorical purpose. From there, the only thing left to do is to start creating an outline or a first draft. So you can see that online shopping is really just research about products, and online research is really just shopping for sources. If you can do one, you can do the other. The fact that we take separate classes from separate teachers in separate semesters often leads us to believe that the knowledge that we have is highly compartmentalized. Surely the principles you've learned about mathematics won't help you in music, and the concepts of psychology would never help you in literature. Of course, that isn't true. There's real power in being able to make connections between the things that you've learned and to transfer skills and knowledge from one area to another. So even though library research might feel like a completely new task that requires you to look for information in new and unfamiliar places, the fact of the matter is that you probably already have the skills to do it effectively. You just need to recognize it and put those skills to work. Once you do that, you'll be well on your way. But remember, too, that research can sometimes be a complex and messy process. So you're not doing it wrong if you have to adjust along the way. That's really how it is for everyone. So give it a go and find those sources that you need with skills that you already have. It might not be the most exciting process, though I guess it is for some people, but it will definitely be easier than you might have initially thought. And with that, good luck, and I'll see you next week.